Hey guys, Dave from Nerdarchy. Four nerds, by nerds, hanging out with these nerds.
Nathan Nerdark.
Ted.
Today we're going to discuss the richest rewards in Dungeons & Dragons. Don't involve gold.
If you want to jump down to the description below, you can sign up for Nerdarchy, the newsletter. It's a great way to get gaming tips, as well as learn how to game with Nerdarchy.
So we had a viewer suggestion to do something on this topic from Matthew. What he wanted to know was about non-standard D&D rewards, and even though we kind of like do a series on how to spend your loot on kind of like different things, but it all kind of involved like stuff, and he was looking for something else. Mm-hmm. So we kind of like, you know, workshopped and talked about it a little bit. You know, he had brought up some really great ideas himself. I don't even think you need the video. We can just read your email to the people. Like a great example, Game of Thrones is Arya Stark when she gets the coin. I'm like, yeah, that's a great idea. So we thought about it. And we're like, you know, there's definitely different categories that fall into this. You know, you have prestige, you have favors and boons, mm-hmm. and then you also have the one we're just calling stuff. And so let's break it down a little bit. Right, what is prestige?
Prestige is going to be things that literally elevate you above the regular populace.
The riffraff.
So if you have like titles or
a bard song.
Bard song. Something that's going to make your name known in the areas that you're at.
I mean, hey, people are still talking about Iliad and the Odyssey kind of stuff, so uh-huh. That was way, way long ago. So someone wrote it down. So if someone writes your tail down, then you
become a legend, yeah. So that stuff is really cool. It may open doors for you, and when it comes to role-playing situations, get you into places you couldn't get into before. People treat you better when you show up, or they treat you worse, you know, because you could be infamous as well.
Yeah, or you could be good to some people, and then you're in the spot where you're not so good.
Yeah, so, you know, in that category, like we said, titles, and even, like, in our own game, you know, Ryan became a mayor. That kind of you know, falls into that category.
He became a mayor in my game and a lord in your game.
Yeah.
I think the lord might have been a self-imposed title.
It depends who you ask.
he might just be running with it.
Yeah. So there's things like that. And then we have, like, boons and favors. Mm-hmm. And they fall under the weird stuff. Like, Arya Stark's coin is actually a boon or a favor.
Yeah.
These type of things, it could be an invitation to join any kind of guild or organization that just being a member is going to open up new doors as well as new quests and things. So getting access, there's going to be the benefits, but it's going to involve more story as well. You've also got just the things that you've done in your game where it's like, oh, you can have a stat bump, or you can have this interesting feature. My character's all over the place with different stuff because he's gotten stat bumps and the ability to not actually have to sleep anymore. He does the elven trance even though he's human. He's got a dragon's breath weapon, or like a dragonborn's breath weapon. Those things fall into a type of boon.
Right, yeah, they're definitely non-standard rewards, and you know, the odd thing about them is it's like you can't trade them in, you can't sell them. They're useful but have no value.
And sometimes they enforce an obligation upon you to interact with things. Like if you become a Thieves Guild member, there's going to be stuff expected of you.
Well, that's the same
as well
thing.
As the benefit of being in the Thieves Guild right. That you get.
Well, it's the same thing if you're considered a lord and you have a title. That title mm-hmm. usually comes with obligations. A lot of this stuff comes with allegations.
Yeah.
Like, we have a catch-all category, too, that we just call stuff, right?
Stuff.
Because in that category would be like, okay, you get the title to land. You get
a business or an orchard.
Yeah, you get a business or, you know, or a sailing vessel. You know, all these things. But maybe contractually you have things that you have to do in order to upkeep them. Like, you get lands. Well, okay, you have the lands. You're garnering the taxes from those lands. But then at the same time, you're also obligated to protect the peasants and make sure everyone stays safe.
You're beholden to those that are working the land that you're on. So, again, another quest element of something is going on, and it's a way that you could insert some of the same quest things that you were doing from earlier in a campaign back in because you didn't complete that quest to what you originally had planned as the DM for them to do, but they like, well, it looks like it's taken care of, so you just sideline that until it's now looped back around.
Well, yeah, you'd be doing it from a different perspective, because if you say, oh, the goblins are attacking this town. All right, well, we're in the town. We're fighting them now. Well, now you're a guy who owns the land that town's next to, and there's goblins attacking. Well, now you have a completely different obligation, expectation, and all kinds of things. You better be protecting those people.
Do you go out and take care of the goblins to yourself, or do you hire adventurers to do it?
Yeah, there's definitely that part that's really interesting, and you're going to have deeper connections to the NPCs in the world. You're going to have deeper bonds to the world itself. You're going to actually start caring about things going on outside of the party. The world is going to kind of open up to the players a lot more, and that's why these rewards, they're going to enrich your gaming experience, and there's going to be so much more role-playing that can happen from it, so many more adventure hooks that can come in, and it changes the scale of those adventures too. Like before, maybe you were doing things locally, but now you're more on a national scale. Like you're dealing with other kingdoms because the titles you have or the lands you own. Maybe the lands you've been given now are in dispute with your neighbor, and that's something you end up having to deal with.
So yeah. It opens.
And he's a Trask.
It opens up the concept for. Not every encounter needs to be a combat. So if your party is looking for more of role-playing challenges, these type of things are going to feed into that level.
Well, exploration as well, I think. I think both of those elements you can really delve a lot deeper into with non-standard rewards. Because, you could find a book, right, that doesn't actually have any value because no one knows what it says. But, when you start uncovering it, there are secrets in there that could lead you on new adventures.
What if you get the title or a deed to an abandoned stronghold, but it's literally just that, and things have moved in?
Or a mine.
Squatters.
So you have to then go explore. It's yours. Everything there is rightfully yours, but there's people or creatures or...
You have to go with a big stack of parchment, lots of ink, maybe a scribe or notary to get everything checked off and hand out a lot of eviction notices.
Well, I was just thinking that it could literally be a dungeon crawl and you're literally exploring...
And giving out eviction notices? No.
No, I don't think eviction
notices. Mage handed into their face. Be like, Gelatinous Cube.
You've been served, bitch!
Get out of here. Yeah, that's really the best reason to have these non-standard rewards is because you're increasing the depth and obligation and interaction of the players with the world.
Are you guys using non-standard rewards in your games? What are they? Let us know in the comments below. While you're at it, like, share, and subscribe.
You can patronize us in a good way over on Patreon.
You can follow us on Instagram.
So until next time,
stay nerdy.